Wednesday, April 14th, a year ago, game one of the first round against Detroit. It was Henrik Sedin then in overtime. This one was almost as exciting to watch. Merrick Malik in one that could provide a huge boost for the
Vancouver
Canucks.
About it. There is a mental block to removing it. Let's show you how we arrived before we head back for reaction. Second period, Henrik Zetterberg coming out of the corner and making it 2-0 Wings. In the third, Matt Cook stopped by Joseph. Trent Klatt is not. He dives and knocks it in. The Canucks back in at 3-2 after trailing 3-0. Brent Sopel then going to work. The shot is wide. Marcus Naslund will score to tie it at 3. 38th of the year for Marcus Naslund in overtime. What a move by Brendan Morrison. What a pass. And what's Merrick Malik doing up there? Jim Houston asked the same question. I will as well. But you know what? Good move. The 4-4 hockey, jump wherever you can. 4-3, the Canucks win. What a monumental comeback. You heard some of the boos coming from the fans at Joe Louis. Was it towards the officials or was it towards Curtis Joseph?
Quickly back to Joe Louis Arena, and Dan Murphy is with the guy that scored the OT winner. Dan, take it away.
Yes, a huge comeback for the Vancouver Canucks. Tonight they came back from 1-0 down going to the third last week against Colorado. 3-0 with 18 minutes to go in this hockey game. Merrick Malik joins me now, the hero of this game. And Merrick, what were you guys saying on the bench when you're down 3-0 with 18 minutes to go in the game?
Well, nothing really. We were just believing in our system, you know, and with a lot of guys, we've been in this situation before, so just stick to our plan and keep going. Go shift after shift, you know, and just put a little bit of pressure on the goalie, and that it works.
Let's take a look at how it happened in overtime. Walk us through it.
Well, we got a little turnover in the neutral zone, and then I don't know. I think Trevor right here, he passed a beautiful pass to Brendan Morrison, and he took two guys on him, and he just slid to me on the side. I was wide open, and I just put it in the net. You know, it was easy, but it was a beautiful job by Trevor and Brendan, and it was kind of easy job for me.
Just a regular season goal, but where does it rank among some of the goals you've scored? You've had two beauties this year.
Well, you know, especially against Detroit, every goal when you score against Detroit is really big, and especially in a game like this when we were down 3-0. So, I just try to do my best and help my team as much as I can, you know, and I got this goal a little bit of help to get us 2 points tonight.
Thanks.
What a night on Sportsnet. A pair of overtime games in Sportsnet Pacific. The Canucks rally from a 3-0 deficit to beat the Detroit Red Wings 4-3. The Edmonton Oilers rally but lose in overtime to Mario Lemieux and the Penguins 4-3. We'll go back to Mellon Arena, see if Jean-Claude Van Damme's made his way in the roof yet for a reaction. Yeah. After we show you how we arrived at the numbers that we did. Two regions with us right now.
Those of you in Sportsnet West saw this. Here's an update for those of you in Sportsnet Pacific. In the second period, Todd Marchand, a nifty pass from Brian Swanson there, ties this game at 2. And then Tarnstrom gets the shot, goes off the boards to the twig of Billy Niemann. And Pittsburgh took a 3-2 lead into the second. On a power play now, Yanni Nienema with the shot. Redirection and a beaut by Anson Carter. Tie game at 3. And then this on the power play. Watch and listen.
Side wide, fires a shot, scores.
Oh, you heard Daniel Cleary afterwards. Not terribly happy with the situation, or maybe you didn't hear him. You will soon hear him. Not very happy with the situation in Pittsburgh right now. The Oilers do get a point out of it, but boy, they're barely holding on to that playoff position at this point.
We will hear from a number of the combatants from both games after we take a break. And when we return, we'll also have the two-minute drill. The hockey panel is standing by as well. It's been quite a night. It's not done yet. Sportsnet Live rolls on right after this.
Grandpa, listen, I'm in Spain and I ran out of money. Is my dad there?
Hang on.
Ever wanted to make your own sausages? Well, get comfortable, because over the next 6 hours, we're going to show you how to turn your garage into a New York-style deli smokehouse. So hang on, our 6 hours...
Grandpa.
Take your time calling from just about wherever you are with an airtime bonus of up to $300 from Rogers AT&T. Imagine.
Coffee and Coffee Crisp. They both taste great, but which one best suits your lifestyle? First, Coffee Crisp. And now, coffee. Coffee Crisp. Yeah! Now, coffee. Yeah! Oh! Coffee crisp. Once again with coffee. Clearly, your lifestyle's better suited to coffee crisp. Chocolate wafers mixed with a fun coffee taste of new French vanilla and triple mocha. How do you like your coffee?
So, please welcome tonight's comedian, the Baltic phenomenon, Yaroslav Popels.
Good evening. Good evening. Иду я по улице и смотрю, там такой мужик маленький. А это ты далеко стоишь от меня?
What if bars catered only to the minority? When it comes to smoking, many do.
Somebody help me, yeah. Somebody help me now. Won't somebody tell me what I've done wrong? Somebody help me, yeah. Somebody help me now. Won't somebody tell me what I've done?
It's become a common occurrence in the National Hockey League. Players like Nick Antropov and Steve Montador thrown out of games for not having their straps tied down. Tonight on Sportsnet News, we find out some surprising details about the number of players breaking this NHL law.
You know, like if you're not a fighter and you're not out there looking to fight, then you're not going to tie down.
Meaning to the term, tie me down. Lots coming up with Don Taylor, 10 o'clock local time on Sportsnet News. News from around the NBA and the National Hockey League, and an intriguing conversation with Mr. Hockey Gordie Howe.
Dan Cleary got his fourth of the year. It opened the scoring tonight, but it was no consolation, as you will see shortly after he left the ice. A very downtrodden Mr. Cleary talked to our Gene Principe.
Thanks very much. We're now joined by the Oilers' Daniel Cleary. And how do you size up a game like that? And you get the late goal and you get the late point, but then lose in overtime.
Thought it was a good, you know, character comeback. Power play's been struggling as of late. We get two tonight, especially that big one late with AC. And I mean, anytime you give a team 4-3, it's, you know, Mario Lemieux on the ice. What can you do?
One of those situations where this is one of those games you take more of the positive as opposed to the loss in the overtime loss column.
Well, I mean, our goal was to win the hockey game. It was a must-win game for us, and we didn't do it. And, I mean, what we can draw out of the game is a point. You know, it was a big comeback victory for us. And, you know, we got to bring that into Detroit. You know, we got to leave the negative energy behind us. And, you know, we're short some key players, but, you know, it's inexcusable. And this is a game we needed to win, and we didn't. I mean, luckily, we got one point.
As a result of missing those players, you get into the lineup. How'd you feel about the impact you had on the game, and especially to start it with your fourth of the season?
You know, it's opportunity. You know, Yorkie went down and I had a chance to come in and got to make the best of what you get out there. And, you know, played okay. You know, got us on the board early, but, you know, usually when you get the first goal, the statistics show you usually come out and win, but tonight we came up a little short. But, you know, we got to regroup tomorrow and focus on Detroit. You know, they're a good hockey club. They're a team that's ahead of us, and we got to come out there with points.
Appreciate your time, Daniel.
Thanks, Gene.
Daniel Cleary of the Edmonton Oilers involved in the Oilers' 19th overtime game of the season, their seventh loss in the extra minutes. Now let's get you back to Sportsnet Live.
Great effort tonight by the Edmonton Oilers, but they fall short to Mario Lemieux and the Penguins in overtime. If you are joining us from a various region, be it Pacific or the West, we're going to review both games and others right now.
Yeah, the West hadn't seen these highlights, Vancouver, Detroit, and Pacific fans will love to see him again. Second period, Henrik Zetterberg out of the corner, gets 12th of the year, make it 2-0 Wings. The third period, the Canucks have been down 3-0. Matt Cook with the shot, Joseph with the save, Trent Klatt, an effort to bury it, knocks it in, takes himself in, Canucks trail up 3-2 despite the protestations of the Red Wings. Brent Sobel with the shot, Marcus Naslund off the boards and in, tying at 3 again. The Red Wings upset. We go to overtime. Here's what happened.
Linden, Morrison's on the fly, beats the defense, passes off. Malik scores! Malik!
4-3, the Canucks win in overtime. What a rally, down 3-0 with 18 minutes to go. They now own a 10-game unbeaten streak and increase their lead over the Red Wings to 5. The Detroit are poised to close it to 2 coming in.
Over at the Mellon Arena, Oilers, Penguins, power play, and look at that pass. Brian Swanson, Todd Marchand, thank you kindly. Marchand's 13th, tied it at two, and then Niemanen banks it off the boards. Takes it from the boards, in fact. Niemanen pots his eighth. It's 3-2 Pittsburgh after two. Yanni Niinimaa with the shot and the redirection done to perfection by Anson Carter. 3-3 game, off to overtime. Here's the end.
Near side wide, fires a shot.
It's as simple as that. Lemieux with 2 points, the winner in overtime. Marchand had a pair of points for the Oilers. Edmonton out shooting Pittsburgh 36-22, but they don't get the pair of points that they required coming in. Carolina in Toronto this night on a power play. O'Neill with a couple of chances. He takes a whack, juicy rebound to number 63, Josef Pasicek. It's 3-2 Carolina, but here comes Tom Fitzgerald. Yeah, just his fourth of the year. Sneaks it by Kevin Weeks, ties the game at three, and then Darcy Tucker, the man many in the NHL love to hate, gets his sixth of the year, and that proves to be the game winner as Toronto continues to roll. The Leafs have won 8 of 9. That current run beginning with a victory over Carolina on January the 29th. Recent winners against the Hurricanes.
Florida and Montreal, second period. Ivan Novoseltz have the Jeff Toms, initially credited to Jay Bouwmeester, but given to Toms, his first of the year, 1-0. Florida. Then Victor Kozlov steals the puck, gets it to Jokinen, and oh, look, knows what to do with these. An all-star, 31 on the year, the quiet 31 down in Miami, 2-0 Panthers. On the power play, Kozlov's got his 17th, and the Habs at home down 3-0. It is now a final no rally for the Montreal Canadiens like the Vancouver Canucks. It's a 3-0 final. The Cats were winless in four. Finally snapped that tonight for Mike Keenan.
Off to Philadelphia we go. New Jersey is there. John Madden down the wing, barrels through and gets his 14th. It's a 1-0 Devil lead at that time. But watch the give and go here. Brashear to Primo out front. He throws it past Brodeur, ties the game at one. By the second, Desjardins with the shot right in front. Mr. Brashear grabs the rebound, and we have a 2-1 Philly lead. But uh-oh. Better get Mako. It's Jeff Friesen capitalizing with about 4 minutes to go in the third. It ends in a Jordan. 2-2 is the final there. The Flyers had lost four straight to New Jersey, including 3 1-0 losses. Those of you in Vancouver might be curious to know that Todd Warner returned to the Flyer lineup after missing two games with a sprained elbow.
Columbus and Phoenix in the second pair. The Jackets 4-2-2 in their last eight, trying to make a late rally under Doug McClain. That's the 2-minute drill. The hockey panel standing by. They will join us when we come back, but we test your brain as we head to break with our What Do You Know? It involves Mr. Hockey. Gordie Howe's epic career began in 1946 in Detroit, but could easily have originated 3 years earlier for the New York Rangers. Interesting stuff. We'll explain when we come back.
When back pain slows you down, turn to Robaxacet with two active ingredients, one to relieve back pain, the other to relax tense back muscles. It's the brand doctors and pharmacists recommend most, so you can get back in the swing. Robaxacet, helping you walk away from back pain.
Hey, watch it!
That guy just cut me off!
Get off! Where'd you get your license? The lucky score!
What are you doing on the road?
Open your eyes!
Come on, move!
What do you know? In 1943, the New York Rangers invited Gordie Howe to their workouts in Winnipeg, but he was homesick and they felt he was too scrawny to play. A year later, he attended the Red Wings training camp and would eventually work his way onto their roster after spending a couple of years in the Wings junior system. You might have heard what he did from that point on. My goodness, we'll go back to Detroit and to Pittsburgh for reaction from the Canucks overtime win and the Oilers overtime loss. Still more pouring in, but first, Jim.
Those of you who watched the Vancouver game probably know now that Mikko Jokela was wearing Darren Langdon, Langdon's undergarments. Yep. I'm certainly hoping Darren Dreger isn't wearing anything in Nick Kypriosis.
Oh, jeez. How do you respond to that? There's no way out of that. We're going to concentrate on what went on at Joe Louis in Detroit and then ultimately take you to Mellon Arena as well, the Edmonton Oilers and the Pittsburgh Penguins. Nick Kypriosis is still here. I thought he might go over to the Sportsnet Live group and knock a few heads around, and he won't. Scott Morrison and Gord Stellick here as well. A bizarre final in Detroit between the Vancouver Canucks and the Detroit Red Wings. Gord, Vancouver scores four unanswered to get things going, but ultimately, Scott, it then turns into the Vancouver Canucks show with Naslin tying it up at three on a bizarre play as well.
Well, Don Van Massenhoven, the referee, one of the referees tonight, won't be the most popular guy in the Motor City, and the puck bounces off his foot. A lucky break, to be sure, for the Vancouver Canucks, and Marcus Naslin, the guy you want to be there in front of an open net with a loose puck, ties up the game at 19:35 of the third period, sending it to overtime, and the previous goal that the Vancouver Canucks scored, they were upset where the Detroit Red Wings and Curtis Joseph figuring there was some goaltender interference, so Van Massenhoven not an ally to the Red Wings tonight.
Talk about a come from behind. I mean, ultimately, the Red Wings chased Dan Klutschke out of the net with a 3-0 lead. So we see Naslin's 38th on the year. Nick, that sets up overtime and an unlikely hero in Marek Milik.
Well, there's a lot of doubters on whether Brendan Morrison is the guy to get the job done, but he certainly proves it on this play. Just a great play, fresh legs. Well, 60 minutes worth of fresh legs. And then over to Malik, who absolutely buries it for the great comeback. And you want to go back to that trade Brian Burke made Malik for Havlek, who went to Carolina. Boy, this is a no-brainer. Berkey won.
Yeah, no kidding. Trevor Linden also drawing an assist on that goal. He had 3 points on this night. But I think, Gord, if you want to look back at perhaps what might have been a turning point in this game, you rewind the tape and you see the Vancouver Canucks really sticking up for one another as things look like they might unravel.
It really was late in the first period, and you see the type of play that winning teams do, and also a lot of leadership. And what we're talking here, Brendan Shanahan likes to get a little nasty. Now Matthias Olin's there. He's going to go for him. Eddie Jovanovski comes from another postal zone, decides he's going to get involved. Luke Robitaille jumps on. That doesn't worry him. But the big point is Brendan Shanahan was going to get a little bit physical. He's a veteran guy. Matthias Olin wants to get physical. He'll get physical. Ed Jovanovski comes. He said, hey, no dice. I'm not stupid. No. And give Eddie Jovanovski credit for jumping in. And those little things that make the difference between winning in regular season, winning in the playoffs.
And I don't know if Vancouver has to send any messages this far into the season. They're obviously the real deal. They're obviously one of the best teams in the National Hockey League, but they continue to impress. They continue to find different ways to win night after night. Tonight, they get some production throughout their lineup. As you mentioned, they come back yet again against a very good hockey club. They did it on Saturday against Calgary. They did it last week against Colorado. They keep making strong, strong statements and shaking monkeys off their back.
Well, and obviously Todd Bertuzzi is out of Mark Crawford's doghouse. He logged over 24 minutes in action tonight against Detroit. Let's switch over to Edmonton and the Pittsburgh Penguins. The Edmonton Oilers since 1993 have really struggled at Mellon Arena. And Tommy Salo, I didn't think, was brilliant in this 4-3 overtime loss against the Pens tonight.
And I agree. Losers of 5 out of 6 now. And Tommy Salo continues to struggle for the W's. And on this goal right here, ends up going down on the initial shot and just does not recover in time. And then in overtime again, although Mario Lemieux got an absolute bullet, that shot should not beat you as well. And just 18 saves on 22 shots. And certainly Edmonton is not getting the goaltending they need. And worse, they're giving reasons for teams like Chicago and LA to hang around and feel like they can still step up for that eighth spot. Mm-hmm. Edmonton's got to get going.
But the good news, they did get a point, and they open up the margin with the Chicago to 4 points, although they use up one of their games in hand.
Have a look at the Western Conference board. We talked about it before that game involving Edmonton and Pittsburgh, and Scott, this illustrates your point. The Oilers in good position, but the work is far from finished.
Well, it's one of those nights. If you're going to lose in overtime, at least you do it against an Eastern Conference team, and they battle back to get the point. But as Nick says, you just can't keep losing stretches like this, 5 out of 6 games. They have to start putting some winning streaks together and put the teams, the likes of Chicago, L.A., San Jose, Phoenix, all of those teams out of their misery while they have the opportunity.
Gentlemen, thank you. Up next for the Edmonton Oilers, they will waddle into Detroit to take on the Red Wings on Thursday. We're looking well past that.
In fact, we're looking at a Saturday. Hockey Central, Chris Simpson will sit down with the captain of the Red Wings. Of course, that's Steve Yzerman talking about his potential return. Join us this Saturday as we get you back to Sportsnet Live.
Gentlemen, thank you. Those in Sportsnet West saw the Oilers lose to Pittsburgh. Shortly afterwards, Gene Principe had a conversation with Charlie Huddy.
The coach's assessment from a game in which you get a late goal and you get a point, but then are beaten in overtime.
Yeah, it's tough to lose that extra point, but you know what? We battled hard in the third period. We had a lot of good chances to go ahead and take the lead, and unfortunately it didn't happen. But we needed a point, and it's a huge point for us right now.
How about the way you battled back down after two and on the road? It seemed like your approach was, if we get enough chances, we know we can get one more by Hudberg.
Well, that's what we were hoping. We just wanted to keep going to the net, keep getting the puck to the net, and hopefully we'd get a break. I mean, he played a pretty solid game for him, obviously held him in there, and we just kept battling away, and fortunate to get that one by Anson.
How'd you feel about the way the power play responded? The Anson Carter goal on the power play, one other one, and getting two with a man advantage tonight.
Well, it's obviously getting better, and we know that it's a huge part of winning and losing hockey games, and it played a huge part in tonight's game, and you know what, we've got to continue to work on it and practice, and hopefully it'll keep getting better for us, and it'll win some hockey games for us.
Appreciate your time, Charlie.
Good, thanks.
Charlie Huddy, assistant coach of the Edmonton Oilers, as they lose in overtime this evening against the Pittsburgh Penguins. Now let's get you back to Sportsnet Live.
Going to go back to Joe Louis, where young Mikko Jokela borrowed one teammate's skates, one teammate's stick, and as Jamie has mentioned, one teammate's undergarment. Let's hear all about that. Well, hopefully not all of it from Dan Murphy.
Thank you. Just 5 minutes before this hockey game was supposed to start, Mikko Jokela called up today for the Vancouver Canucks because Brian Allen had the flu. Sammy Salo out with an injury. Mikko joins me now. And have you ever come to a game 5 minutes before it was supposed to start?
No, I don't really remember that. I've come only 5 minutes before the game straight from the airport, so it was the first time.
Tell us a little bit of what you had out there. I understand you had Trent Klatt's skates to start. You had Sammy Sella's gloves. You had Brent Sopel's stick. How tough is it to step into all that new stuff?
Well, everything else is okay. Like, you can take the every other equipment except the skate. When you don't get your own skates or your own stick and stuff, those are the most important thing. Like, without your own skate, it just feels pretty bad over there.
Did you have time to get nervous because you came out, got on the ice, had your first shift, and got your first shot right away? Were you nervous?
Well, of course, my first time over here, so I had the time to get nervous too, so I was a little nervous to start, but when I got the first shift and the first shot and stuff like that, I started to feel a little bit better over there.
Not a bad game for your first NHL game. How excited were you on the bench to see the team win in overtime?
Oh, really excited. It was really nice. We were losing 3-0 and came back from there and winning in overtime, so that's just a great game.
Thank you for joining us, Mikko, and congratulations and good luck the rest of the way.
Thank you.
Mikko Jokela, the newest Canuck, playing in his first NHL game tonight with not all of his equipment until the third period. Back to the desk.
Guys, thanks. Dan's out looking for new clothes for his new friend on the Canucks, and as Darren Dreger mentioned, 3 points for Trevor Linden tonight among these other numbers.
I hope Miko's teammates aren't teasing him about being a cross-dresser.
Yeah.
Mark Howe was a pretty good defenseman, twice a first-team All-Star. To illustrate how brainless some people can be, one night a fan screamed relentlessly at him, saying, "You're not as good as your father." Howe's nifty reply was very simple. Who was? Time for the high-low of the night, and with that, the high is this.
He'll give it to Lemieux. Mario Lemieux setting up, near side, wide, fires a shot, scores!
But I'm on that to keep me from killing y'all.
I'm no new Mike Tyson. No, that's not true. I'm just tired of being stupid. I'm just having fun now.
I guess that's the low. Mm-hmm. Mike Tyson's tattoo.
Yeah, now you see, if the fan had yelled at Mark Howe, "You're not as good as your brother," then that would be
more
of an insult. Oilers hockey comes your way Thursday night. It's the same Detroit Red Wings that the Canucks beat in overtime. As for the Vancouver Canucks, it's the St. Louis Blues, one of the teams they're battling with for playoff position. Don't discount these games, even though playoffs are a little ways to go. Stay tuned. Junior hockey on the way. Seattle and Vancouver. And I believe Gordie Howe is going to be honored before this game. Don Taylor is up after that.
For Vancouver head coach Dean Evason, there's no such thing as a sophomore jinx. The second-year franchise is poised for a trip to the postseason. Leading the charge is Darren Lynch, last year's team MVP, is once again the Giants' offensive catalyst. And it's tough to contain Adam Korshane. He's already found the net 37 times. The Seattle Thunderbirds are the best from the U.S., but it's Canadian Brooks Like who keeps them charged. Coming off the silver medal performance of the World Junior, the product of Wawota, Saskatchewan, is the current WHL Player of the Week. And don't forget veteran Greg Black. He loves to play giant killer. For the seventh time, the T-Birds tangle with the G-Men, and it's next on the net.
The Canadian Hockey League on Sportsnet.
The Pacific Coliseum in Vancouver, the home of the second-year franchise of the Western Hockey League, the Giants. And tonight, they enter.